And we are back here at 8:07 a.m. and on line one this morning, as we promised, is the man himself, Scott. What's up this morning?
Good morning, Dave. How are you?
Yeah, Scott Braddock, editor of the Quorum Report, quorumreport.com. Hey, Scott, I think the biggest news of the week, I didn't see it in your email, was the Wendy Davis Peloton or whatever commercial that was ridiculous.
Well, I mean, everything is. This is politics in, let's just go ahead and say, in the year 2020. We're in the 2020 cycle now, right?
Uh-huh.
And it defies parody. If they were going to do it on Saturday Night Live, what would they do other than just show it?
Yeah, that's true.
Right?
It was that kind of commercial.
What did you think?
I don't know. To me, I'm not a big Wendy Davis fan, and so...
Right.
I watched it and I just laughed. I thought it was funny.
Yeah, and I didn't understand the there was so much outrage over that Peloton ad in the first place that I didn't. I mean, I'm sure you both saw it. You all saw it. I didn't understand all of the outrage. I saw that the company itself, the valuation dropped by about $1 billion. Their stock went down about 15%. And as somebody who looks for value, I thought they created a buying opportunity for the stock.
That's true. But
it'll go back
I think,
up at some point, because believe me, people love those bikes.
Oh yeah, yeah, they love them, and they're just way overpriced.
Right, right. So maybe that'll all get corrected now.
Yeah. Well,
over one commercial.
The thing I thought was funniest about that commercial from Wendy Davis is that in the tweet she added aviation gin. Which, as you know, they made fun of that commercial, too.
Yes.
But it was just like, where did that come from? Anyway, I'm sorry. I had to bring that up a little bit
to make fun of
Wendy Davis.
You know what? It's funny, but it's also relevant because that race and races like it around the state, and by like it, I mean these races that are going to happen in these suburban districts are going to be defining for the year 2020 in Texas. You know, what's going to happen in what we're calling the new melting pot of the suburbs around the state, places like that, which, of course, that district runs between Austin and San Antonio, taking a lot of the suburban areas in, some rural parts of that district as well, of course, do matter. But if you look around the state, it's those places. It's Fort Bend County as well. It's Collin County, Denton County, Tarrant County, Williamson County, where we're looking at those as the new battlegrounds. Why are we looking at it that way? It's not wishful thinking on anybody's part. I think it's that, look, you look at the numbers, and that's where things shifted. When the statewide election results were different in 2018, going from, Republicans leading by 20 points 4 years earlier in 14 to just about 2.5 points, something like that, all across the state, those numbers tracked in all those suburban areas. And you saw some Democrats win where they would not have been possible even 2 or 4 years ago. And if they didn't win, they came really close. It's got Republicans thinking they got to change things up about how they run these campaigns.
Yeah, I mean, it was a huge shift very, very quickly.
Right.
Is kind of what it boils down. Because I lived in Williamson County, and
mm-hmm.
and it was very conservative when I lived there, and
right.
that was not that long ago. So,
not the case. people are moving in so fast. This is finally the result of all this inbound migration to Texas. And I mean from, other parts of the country. People moving in from California, people moving in from New York, people moving in from all over the place. And as we've talked about before on the show, it's not necessarily that those folks are more liberal, but it is the case that they maybe have some different thoughts and maybe vote a little bit differently. There was quite a bit of backlash to President Trump and to Senator Cruz in 2018. There were 500,000 people who voted for the Democratic nominee for senator, and then voted for Governor Abbott and for Comptroller Hager and for Sid Miller, et cetera. So those are folks who don't think quite the way a lot of the voting population had thought about things in previous cycles in Texas. You were either all Republican or all Democratic, for about 20 years around here.
Yeah.
And that's already shifting up. And now, going into 2020, the big structural difference will be that people can't even push that one button for straight ticket Republican or Democratic. And the way people vote when they don't have that option may look more like a Mountain West state, like Nevada
Republicans.
Or Colorado or Montana or one of those sorts of places.
I miss my straight ticket vote.
You know, it's an interesting deal. When they made that change, and by the way, it was a local Republican Party county chairman all over the state, particularly in rural counties, who said, don't do that. And why did they do it? Well, I mean, the backstory on it is that Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick was not interested in making that change until his son, who had been a judge in Harris County, lost to a Democrat in a big Democratic sweep. And he said, oh, well, maybe we should get rid of the straight ticket voting thing. So then they got rid of it, and they voted to do that. But they delayed it by one cycle so that it would not take effect in 2018. Now it'll take effect in 2020. And when they made the decision, it was thought that 2018 would be sort of a normal midterm election. And, of course, that didn't happen at all. What happened was an election in which you had almost presidential-level turnout of 8.4 million people. And this is something to watch very closely, gentlemen. If the Democrats are able to take back the Texas House in the year 2020, which we've talked a lot about here on KFYO, it's a very real possibility. If they do, then Republicans won't be able to do what? They won't be able to put that back in place. They could just change the law again, you know, Matt. They could just say, you know what, we tried that and it didn't work out. Let's go back to straight ticket voting. But if Democrats take the House, that won't happen.
Even more importantly, they won't be able to gerrymander.
I don't understand why they would ever take that away to start with.
Well, the thought was that in places like, particularly in Houston, Harris County has the third longest ballot in the United States. In the general election, and the thought was that if they delinked the races, then the local Republicans would have a better chance to hang on. And this really speaks to a real tension. And by the way, they're thinking the same way in Dallas County, Tarrant County, et cetera. There's a tension between urban Texas and suburban Texas and rural Texas, right? You had those, small county party chairmen saying, please don't do that. They would say it's our whole campaign in November just to say, vote Republican. In places like Houston and Dallas, the politics are very different, and they want to be able to give those judge candidates and state house candidates a shot at winning their races when the voting population seems to be trending more and more Democratic.
Hey, Scott. Look in your crystal ball and tell us what is going to be the biggest story of 2020.
I think in Texas you may well see a Democrat win statewide. That I'm not going to predict it, but that's what you need to watch. And when I say statewide, I mean I don't necessarily mean the Senate race, but there are some other things that are on the ballot, like Railroad Commission, for example. Decades ago, when the state started to shift from Democratic, remember, for about 100 years, it was all Democrats running everything in Texas, and then the Republicans started to take over. But the way that it happened was some of those, what you would call, you know, sort of down ballot, maybe more insignificant races than certainly not governor or, you know, senator right out of the gate. But you go back and you look, although Senator Towers folks would take issue with that. But if you look, you know, years ago, with some of those smaller races where, what do you know, all of a sudden the Republicans winning over here and over there. And so if we do see a shifting attitude in the state about who's going to be elected statewide, it'll be some of those races.
Well, but I remember back then, the Democrats are about like Republicans are now.
We had
a very conservative group of Democrats that ran the state of Texas.
Very conservative group of Democrats, and what happened was Governor Richards, who was, of course, pretty liberal Democrat, but not conservative. No, she was sort of emblematic for Republicans as far as it being like the like a liberal Tea Party. She and the liberals in the party, and she joked about this later in life. She talked about how the liberals in the Democratic Party, they set out to try to, you know, kind of purify the Democratic Party and drive all of the conservatives out of the Democratic Party. And she later joked, she says, you know, unfortunately, we were very successful because all of those conservative Democrats became Republicans and then started whipping their butts at the ballot box.
Yeah, and I mean, honestly, I think that Ann Richards was probably the end of the Democrat Party. I mean, I think she personally kind of destroyed it in Texas for a while.
The lesson there for Republicans is that, you know, maybe all this party purification, certain folks who, you know, want everything to be as conservative as possible,
and certain organizations,
some folks out of the Republican Party, and then you drive some more people over to the Democratic side. It can happen to to both sides, really.
So Scott, I know we're running out of time, but I just I wanted to ask you what's happening over in England. Do you think that's going to have anything to do with over here? I mean, you've got Johnson winning. Do you think that that's separate? They're just trying to get Brexit done. They're worried about the terrorists, like with that came on the London Bridge, or do you think that that's a movement that because sometimes it seems like what happens over there happens here.
It's an interesting question, right, because you do have this sort of rise of the strong man, not just in the UK and the United States, but in Western nations, you know, writ large. You know, I think their elections are very specific to some of the issues and candidates that were happening there. I mean, the sort of the Liberal candidate, the Labour guy, Corbyn.
Oh, Corbyn's terrible. He's not
terrible candidate. Yeah. And importantly, he didn't take a position on the most important issue in the election. Right, which is Brexit. He decided not to do that. He said, well, I'll leave that to the people, which I think people didn't want to hear that. They want to hear, you know, what do you think about it and what are you going to do about it?
Yeah.
And so I think that gave a lot of strength to, you know, the case that was being made by Johnson, et cetera, and his folks. As far as what it means for here, hard to tell. You know, I know a lot of folks want to think that we would follow those folks, but we have a pretty independent streak around here in the United States. There's a reason we're not in the UK anymore. We were sort of the original Brexit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Scott Braddock, editor of the Quorum Report. Go to quorumreport.com. What do you have going on in Quorum Report right now?
Actually, today, watch for this, the last hearing that has anything to do with the Speaker Bonin scandal is happening at 10 o'clock. The General Investigating Committee is going to let us know if, you know, if anything, you know, what they're going to do about the Texas Rangers reports about that meeting that Bonin had with Michael Quinn Sullivan that led to the downfall of the Speaker. It may be, gentlemen, you know, guess what, that they're just trying to sweep this under the rug the Friday before Christmas. But you never know. We'll keep an eye on it for you. QuorumReport.com.
All right. Thanks, Scott. We'll talk to you, what, in about 3 weeks?
Absolutely. Happy New Year.
All right.
Thank you, Scott.
Happy New Year. Thanks.
8:19 a.m. as we move along this morning. We'll take a quick break, come back, and close out the week. And a Friday here on KFYM Mornings with Matt and Dave.